we've been having a bit of fun with a 1965 fire engine. Bob Perry is our man. Bob, fire her up. Sensational. I think we better not have any more of that, lest we wake up the neighbours. I suppose they should be awake by now. G'day, Bob. How are you?
Pleased to meet you.
The Birdwood Classic. Now, this is a 65 international fire engine. Certainly. How did you manage to get this?
Well, I was approached when it came out of service at the Metropolitan Fire Service, because it was in service up until about 4 years ago down at Victor Harbour. And they said, look, hey, are you interested in buying this? And I had expressed an interest in buying a fire truck before.
As you do.
Yeah, exactly.
And am I right in saying that you kept this in a chook shed, or you still do?
No, I don't keep it in a chook shed anymore. I kept it there for about 3 months because I hadn't worked out a way to break it to my wife that I'd actually bought a fire truck. I bought it home. I had it sitting in the carport and she thought I was looking after it for somebody else. But then she went to America and came back and she said, look, I need to go back to America. I said, funnily enough, I bought a fire truck.
Talented man being able to hire a fire truck.
You've got to pick your moment.
Let's go down to the business end of the International 65.
The good thing about a fire truck is you've got heaps of cupboard space.
Oh,
and
lovely.
We've got all the fire stuff that we need in here. In fact, here's a helmet. You better put that on.
Oh, look, I better put that on just so I look vaguely authentic.
So you feel part of it.
Yep.
We've got enough here to fight a fire. We've got hoses. We've got nozzles. We've actually got an air set here so that we've got pickle onions for lunch today and we might just need that this afternoon. Just in case somebody's forgotten the can opener for the potato salad, I'd bring that along too. You know,
very scary indeed. Well, while we're talking picnicking, I know for a fact that Bob actually has got a bit of picnic gear hidden away.
Picnic basket in here.
Look at this. Fantastic.
We're going to do it tough. We're going to have coffee as well.
I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, burns, burns.
Amazingly, it only took Bob about 6 months to get this fabulous beast back to pristine condition. But he was lucky. For most of the restorers in the Birdwood Classic, we're talking about years of hard work and dedication.
Heaven would be cruising around in one of these big old girls with just, you know, the rock and roll music, the music of that car's era, playing, not loud like they do now, just playing gently, and the burble of the big motor just rumbling away, pushing it along effortlessly. I saw in a picture in a book, it was a 64 Thunderbird, and I knew what a Thunderbird was, but I didn't know all the models. And it just was just a click, this fantastic, it was a side profile, black and white photograph, very tiny in a magazine, and I just, that's my car, that was my car.
Bottom line was we went looking for another car and we failed to get that, failed to achieve that, and we just went after this one. But when I saw it, it was a very daunting thing to buy.
And I think Dad was more worried than what I was. He said, are you all right? And you don't feel a little bit sick in the stomach or anything? I said, no, I'm really wrapped. I was pumped.
Photograph the interior. Once again, it doesn't look too bad, but it was quite badly water damaged.
You could tell that there was a big V8 motor under there somewhere. It had the right look, you know, but we just had to clean all the scunge off of it, and, you know, even some of the parts on the engine had actually been damaged. Why do fools fall in love? Why do birds sing so gay? Love is my way to break the pain. Why do they fall in love? Because we fixed it in the front yard, we had all these religious types and people selling stuff walking in, and yeah, they wouldn't, you know, you try not to be rude, but, you know, you're in a pool of oil under a car, you know, and you're really not interested. You just want to get that nut or that bolt off. You've scunned your knuckles on it twice already. You know, the last thing you need is a Mormon trying to sell you something.
It was actually a bare metal strip-off job, and it took a long, long time with a lot of borrowed tools, and the results, well, that's the body coming back.
Yeah, I'd come home from work and he'd say, oh, Jay, I've got your electric windows going up and down. Look at that, they work really good, you know. And I'd say, real excellent, Dad, no worries. You know, lucky they weren't cracked or anything. But, yeah, and
generally there'd be a bunch of receipts on the table, and yeah, I'd reimburse him, but it was well worth it because he didn't charge me for labour, so that was pretty good.
You'd never afford me.
No, it's too expensive.
Here's my story, it's sad but true.
I think Mum did rather well putting up with it, putting up with us being out in the shed until all hours and driving down to Adelaide every couple of weeks for the whole afternoon on a Saturday, trying to find parts and picking up parts and, yeah, that sort of talking cars all the time around the dinner table. When we drove it up the main street of Gawler, yeah, everyone sort of looking, oh wow, it was the most unusual car anyone had ever seen. And I think that's what I like about it. It's just, it's a bizarre looking car.
I like cars, always have liked cars, and through buying my first American car, I met my fiance, worked with my dad on the car, and we became closer than what we were before, and I also met my best mate Mike, who's got the sister car to my car, and buying the Thunderbird, all that money and all that work is paid off tenfold, I believe, and it's just the best thing I've ever done. Gila.
What's actually gone wrong today?
The main line to the battery is earthed out on the body and started fire.
Now, you must be one of the luckiest classic drivers, though, because the RAA have shown and helped fix it up straight away.
Yeah, well, we were just ringing them just a few minutes ago, and then suddenly they appeared out of nowhere, just like that.
Paul, this is the joy of actually being a car restorer, isn't it?
A truck restorer in this case, yes. We've got a fuel problem. It's an old two-stroke diesel. And from 1962, but she's not quite done what she ought to have today.
But you've come extremely well prepared. You've got a whole mat of spanners out here. Were you expecting this?
No, we weren't, but it's always good insurance to bring a big tool, Robin. You never need it. It's when you haven't got them that you do need them, so.
There's a huge traffic jam of classic cars out here anyway, so I don't think there's any trouble. You've got plenty of time still to get there.
Well, if we don't get it fixed soon, we'll be heading off anyway, because we don't want to miss the picnic.
The food is everything. The trucks doesn't matter.
Well, it does actually. I'd hate to leave it here, not to make it, but we'll give it a bloody good shot.
Once we were through the breakdown valley of Ridgehaven, it was time to hit the hills and the classic motoring of the afternoon.